I'm Ryan Hollweg, NHL veteran, and I'm coming on I Only Touch Greatness podcast. Check it out.
Yay, Brad Wingfield, former Danbury Trasher here. Check me out on I Only Touch Greatness podcast.
Looking for the most beers on tap, great steaks, great staff? Head over to the John B. Pub.
We got the best beers, steaks, chicken wings, nachos in town. Come see us at the John B. Pub.
The John B. Pub, the best bar in town. Come sign up for our football pool. Say hey, St. Ying.
Turn it up. The number one sports podcast in Vancouver with Ryan Hayes and Big Mike.
Ryan Hayes and Big Mike are taking over the podcast scene in Vancouver. Get down or lay down.
Now, Winger comes in with an overhand right. Both men are punching hard. Winger missing a shot. We're going to have a fight. And it's going to be Wingfield and LeBlanc. Wingfield takes some noogies to the head. Now, Wingfield bouncing back with some left. They're tangled up right now. Wingfield trying to get up. Now, he gets pulled down. LeBlanc missing with a right to the chest. Wingfield, a veteran of 10 seasons in pro hockey. And LeBlanc is 20 years old. Tangled up now. A couple of shots. LeBlanc gets hit to the back of the head. Wingfield tries to pick LeBlanc up. Now they're both standing up right now. Wingfield with a right to LeBlanc as they continue tangled up. Wingfield now nearly is going to be in trap.
Darcy Hordachuk and Ryan Hollweg. A couple of former Western Leaguers.
We'll be right back. So we'll start off with Brad, born in Gibson. You just told us you're back and back living there now. So tell us a little bit about childhood and when did you start playing hockey?
Yeah, I'm actually born in North Vancouver. I think my mom was scared of the hospital up here back in the 70s. So I started playing hockey. I started skating when I was three, but I didn't play organized hockey till I was eight. For some reason, I was a soccer kid. So go figure, right? But yeah, and then I played here on the coast. There was no rep hockey or anything. So at in Bantam, me and another guy, a good friend of mine, Mike Lewis, we went headed up north to Paul River and we played rep hockey for a couple of years in Bantam and up in Paul River.
Oh, right on, right on. And Ryan, born in Cali, I know you left at a pretty early age to come to the BC Hockey League. Tell us a little about moving out so early and childhood.
Yeah, well, I just got a comment first, and I couldn't even imagine Winger being with those legs. Holy cow, being a soccer player. I just see you getting up and down the field. Anyways, yeah, I mean, I even had a little soccer stint when I started off. Grew up in Los Angeles, you know, started off playing soccer actually as well. And I had a father who's from Brazil, and my mom was from Vancouver, just outside of Vancouver in Burnaby. And yeah, I guess hockey ran in on the mother's side. My grandfather played some professional hockey, so I was pretty active as a kid, and always wanted to be doing something. Just a ball of energy, as my mom would say. But I remember she took me down to one of the local rinks when I was 4 years old, and I just fell in love with the game immediately. And I just knew from the first time I stepped on the ice that hockey was going to be a part of my life and a big part of it. And eventually, you know, the dream was to become an NHL hockey player, and, you know, did all right, I guess.
Yeah, you did. And what are some of your hobbies outside of sports for both of you guys?
I'll let you take it, Winger.
Oh, yeah. Well, for me right now, it's basically work and hockey. That's all really there's time for. Work for a development company, driving a gravel truck, running some excavator. That's just the daytime gig. And then I'm the director of hockey operations here on the Sunshine Coast and the head coach. So most evenings, lucky tonight, I'm off. But it's right from work to the rink till about 9 at night. So that's really all my hobbies are. Just getting back into working out. I've been off for a few years, just dealing with a beat-up body and all that. So trying to get back into working out. Luckily enough, through COVID, I built a home gym here for my oldest son that's playing at the Northwest Hawks there in Ryan's program. So not for Ryan in particular yet, but yeah, so that's all I got right now for hobbies and what I'm doing.
Okay.
Yeah, I don't know. I like to do a lot of stuff. Hockey's still a big part of my life, but I love camping. I love golfing. Spending time with my son, who you know, he lives in Europe with his mom. So I get to go over to Europe and you know, have some good trips with him. And I was fortunate to have him over here this summer. But yeah, you mean you pretty much you name it. I like to do it. I'm adventurous. I like to do things outside the box and take myself outside of my comfort zone. So, but like Brad said, I'm coaching hockey now, with the Vancouver Northwest Hawks program, which is based out of North Vancouver. And I'm the head coach of the U18 AAA team. So it'll be my first stint as a head coach and looking forward to getting the season going. It's been a rough couple of years for these kids. So it'd be nice to get back in the rink with some fans and some parents. They get to come watch their kids again. And we start up this weekend on Saturday. So I'm really looking forward to the hockey season, just getting going here.
Awesome. Hey, yeah, we're huge fans too, so we can't wait. What's up?
And you know, you said North Van. Would that be – that wouldn't be the same rink, Bedard?
Yeah, did Bedard come out of there? Yeah, Connor Bedard.
Yeah, well, yeah. So our catchment is North Vancouver – is like the main probably part of our zone. And yeah, I know Connor a little bit. I coached him a little bit, just kind of doing like development stuff. Yeah. Great kid. It's just a very special type of player, that's for sure.
Yeah,
I mean, even 3 years ago, you know, we were bringing him out for our U18 skates, and he just makes guys like silly out there. It's hilarious. Just the kid, yeah, is so,
he's
gifted.
So good.
Yeah,
oh, yeah, so good.
Pretty special player. Keep an eye on him for sure, coming down the pipeline here. But He's gonna be a fun player to watch for sure.
Yeah, that's for sure. And great family. We've met Thomas and his mom a few times, and then Connor a bunch of times, right? And we actually had him on the show too. So good kid from local guy, and it's nice to see a superstar coming out of the West Coast.
Yeah, for sure.
No doubt.
Hey, Brad, I don't know if you know Gilbert Brulé at all, but I was actually just at his place over on the Sunshine Coast. So he'd be someone to get connected in to get into your hockey thing too, because he's retired now, just living the dream.
Yeah, you know what? I sent a shout-out to him through Instagram there a while back and gave him my phone number and told him when he's ready to coach, give me a call. And so we're still holding out hope, waiting to hear from him.
Okay. Yeah, sweet. Yeah, I was just over at his place. It's beautiful, man. It was awesome. I had a great time with the wife over there.
Yeah, Mayor, you might just have to show up at his doorstep and knock on the door.
I think I know where he lives in Roberts Creek, so I might have to.
Yeah, it's pretty easy. Drive down the highway and look for the gate. You can't miss it. So, Brad, you played your junior hockey in the BC Hockey League as well. I'll bring you back to those days. And did you enjoy being there before going pro?
Oh, for sure. Like, I was, like I said, I moved to Paul River moved up there to play rep hockey and was raised on the BCHL, at the time BCJHL. I didn't know a whole lot about the Western Hockey League, to tell you the truth. I wasn't raised on that. I was raised on the Kings up in Paul River. And so to get into that league, it's, you know, maybe I set my goals a little lower or whatever, but it turned out great. It was an awesome league to play in and be part of. And obviously that's where I got my start.
And then Ryan, obviously, going to the Dub, 1999, first overall pick to Medicine Hats. That's great. A pretty big accomplishment right there as it is. A couple good seasons there in the Dub as well. Bring us back to those days. Give us a story or two.
Yeah, I mean, it was, you know, coming from California, I really didn't know anything about the Western Hockey League. I did play a year in the BCHL as well with Langley before I moved up to the Dub, but played in the BCJ as a 15-year-old, got Rookie of the Year, then was the first American-born player ever drafted first overall in the Western Hockey League draft. So, you know, didn't really even know what the draft was till I started having these teams come and wanting to meet with me, but it was a great – I mean, I would never change anything. I mean, I think my experience in the Western Hockey League and playing in Medicine Hat, it was awesome. It was playing in a smaller town like Medicine Hat. You really felt like you were the big, you know, the big show there, and the whole place comes out, the whole city comes out to watch, and they support you when you're doing great, and they're hard on you when you were losing. And it was a pretty unique experience going to Wet Medicine Hat because when I got there, they were kind of the laughing stock of the league. They hadn't made the playoffs in over 10 years. They had been stockpiling first rounders like myself, Jay Bomeister, some other notables like Joffrey Lupo, and some pretty good players come up, and we were able to grow that program and get it back to the level where the city remembered it. And that's, you know, winning back-to-back Mem Cups in the 80s and the Trevor Linden era. So I feel pretty fortunate to be part of that whole process. I was part of the team at a really rough part of their existence, and you know, by the end of it, I was the captain of the team as a 20-year-old, and you know, we won the league, and we got to go to the Memorial Cup. So I really think I got to see that program from its worst and be a part of the amazing program that it is now. And they've never lost momentum there. They've always been competing at the top of the league since I left, and you know, that's a huge shout out to Willie Desjardins too. Willie was my coach in Medicine Hat when my 19-year-old year, he came in and he just really embraced the opportunity to play for an amazing guy like him. He just turned the organization around and made it a lot of fun to go to the rink every day. And it was an awesome time. Great 5 years for sure.
Yeah, holy. So if you guys were having, this is for both of you, if you're having a dream dinner party and you can invite three famous people, I know Brad's famous now, if you could invite any three famous people that are alive, who would you want to bring?
Well, I'm going to go, I'll throw one out there right now. And I've talked to this guy on the phone and played with his brother, but for me, it's got to be Wayne Gretzky.
Yeah. Okay.
Paul, you're up, buddy.
I mean, for me, I think I don't know. Who would I want? I'd like to have a mix. I think I'd like to sit down with Chael Sonnen, MMA fighter. He seems to be like a pretty good personality. He's a pretty funny guy. I think it'd be pretty pretty cool to hang out with him for a little bit and pick his brain. I'm sure we'll hear some good stories through that guy for sure.
Is there any other ones?
Oh, I could keep going here. If we're going to go on the MMA track, me and Ryan are both huge fans. Stipe Miocic, the all-time greatest heavyweight champ. He's another guy. But, I mean, guys like Michael Jordan, you got to throw him out there. I've been to dinner with this guy, but a good buddy of mine I grew up with is Ryan Dempster. We can keep going on and on.
Okay.
Ryan, do you have two more? I always go with Muhammad Ali, Wayne Gretzky, and you got to have a little eye candy, Carrie Underwood.
There you go.
Nice. And for me, it's always Tupac, Seth Rogen, the comedian, and then Hulk Hogan.
Oh, the Hulk.
Yeah.
I like to throw Macho Man in there too, man. I guess.
Yeah. Hey, I just if we're going to get in on this, I got to spend one night with John Cena when he had his heavyweight belt and the spinner belt, and I was sporting that around for a
while.
Was
that
night.
When he came and dropped the puck?
Yeah, that's right. So I think I was either had my a broken leg or I was suspended. I imagine it was the broken leg, but I was up and about, and I took his John Cena in the back and showed him the dressing room and all that. I think we even did some bench presses in our gym. So it was pretty wild just to sit and bullshit with him just one-on-one. It was cool.
I actually just ordered the jersey yesterday when it came out online. So I got the Trashers jersey on the way.
Oh yeah, I see. I think they just worked a deal with Verbero. So
yeah, that's the one I got. Yeah, I saw that.
Andy, it's Andy Sutton's company. Yeah, because we had AJ on a couple nights ago. So he's telling us all about that.
AJ basically said he was whooping your ass at some NHL hockey.
Oh yeah,
multiple games. Right.
He likes to talk shit, but he forgets from 04 to 06, I was actually the Eastern Seaboard Xbox NHL champion. So AJ can put a spin on that all he wants, but deep down he knows who the champ was 04 to 06.
Plus, Winger's missing a finger, too. That's not fair.
Oh, yeah. I'm supposed to ask you about how we all, I'm supposed to ask you about that, too. How did we lose the finger?
I was in the Quebec League, and before I was in that league, I've never been in a bench-clearing brawl. And after 2 years, I don't know, I was probably in about 10 of them. And, these things are, your life's on the line here, let's just say. So, there's 40-man brawl going on, and the refs can't really break it up. So this thing's, you're waiting until you guys tire out. We tire out. But you know what? I think it was Trois Rivières is who it was against, I believe. But I got down to the dressing room, and I didn't even know anything was wrong with it. And everyone was sitting down there just chilling out, the adrenaline coming down, and I just felt a pain in my finger. You know, give it a little shake, and I looked, and that thing was it was twisted in all the wrong ways.
Oh, nasty.
So I was like, yeah, not good. So I went into a surgery the next day, I think it was, to try to fix it. And it ended up getting infected, and I got hospitalized, and you're supposed to be this big, tough guy, and you get hospitalized by a pinky, and you start to question yourself.
And Ryan, take us back to probably the biggest day in your career, getting drafted 238th overall to the New York Rangers in 01.
Yeah, I mean, obviously, for me, like I said, I from the moment I stepped on the ice, I wanted to play in the NHL. That was the dream, just like a lot of other kids. And I'm so fortunate to be able to have been able to reach my goals and my dreams and live that life out. And I remember the day I got drafted. It was just, it was a huge day. It was obviously, a big step in the right direction. And I know getting drafted doesn't mean you're going to ever play, but it was definitely, the first step that needed to get done and to have that opportunity. And it was pretty amazing. I got the call, and I remember I was still in school, but I found out from my agents, and being able to go to a team like the New York Rangers, original six team, a lot of history, an amazing city. It was pretty special. So probably one of the proudest days of my lives. And I know, my family were really proud of me as well, but would have never been able to get there or accomplish that without the help and support of my family, for sure.
Of course. And Brad, how did the original I didn't go down with Danbury. Like, how did that all go down? AJ call you? Or
it was the equipment manager there, T-Bone Pompicello. When I was in Elmira, he was in New Haven, and I hated that guy.
Man, I want that guy as my trainer.
Dude, he's just runs his mouth and runs his mouth. But regardless, without him, and I would have never got to Danbury. So obviously, you heard at the time this guy was connected, and he would let you know too. And so when he first phoned me up, I was like, "Who the fuck is this? The equipment manager from New Haven?" I'm like, "I'll talk to you later." And click. I told my wife, laugh, and she's like, "Who was that?" I'm like, "Oh, it's this equipment manager. I don't even like the guy." And he called back the next day. Listen, he says, "Just listen. I'm gonna have this guy Jimmy call you." I'm like, "Oh yeah, who's Jimmy? Like, I know who Jimmy is." "Okay, you get Jimmy to call me." And lo and behold, this guy Jimmy calls, and I'm like, you can hear the seriousness in the guy's voice, and I was like, "Whoa!" And he's like, "How about I'll fly you and your wife down here for a recruitment trip to Danbury?" And I was like, "Oh, free trip to JFK. I'm in." So yeah. We ended up going there, and just like I say, you know, we T-Bone picks us up, and you know, we're over that we didn't like each other's stuff, and he drives us into Connecticut, and we go to a dump, like an actual dump, and I'm just like, what planet is this? And as you get into the offices and you go up the floors, the nicer it gets till you get to this guy's office, and boom, lo and behold, you get in there, and I met Jimmy. He seemed like a good guy to me, and I just remember that his eyes are just piercing, like really scary eyes. And he was a nice guy, and we talked, and he asked me what T-Bone office was going to pay me. I told him, and he was like, "I'll pay you," like, it was almost double what this guy. I was like, "Holy smokes." He threw out 10 G's. You know, I think my wife snatched it out of the air before I could even touch it. She had that in her purse. And Jimmy, he actually put a standard UHL player contract down on the table, pen, and said sign it, and I was like, whoa. I never had negotiations go like that before, but it was a hell of a deal, and like, no doubt I was gonna sign that contract. It was probably gonna make me sign it.
Yeah, right. But you would have lost another finger.
That's right.
Exactly. But this contract was so good for that level that I was signing that thing. And I remember walking out of there and looking at Sarah and just like, "Guess we're coming to Danbury." And we already had a tour of the place, and it was just beautiful. We were, you know, excited and a little worried how things were going to work. But obviously it worked out how everyone saw, and it was awesome to be there, be part of that.
Big question. Out of curiosity, what was your first impression of AJ?
What do you think? Come on, man. What was your first impression, guys?
Well, my first impression was we wore the same size clothes and everything back in 2004. We all had the baggy stuff. Everything was hip hop.
Yeah, well, right.
Even John Cena was rocking those shorts when he came out.
That's right.
Yeah, and I heard AJ saying that on one of his podcasts I was listening to. Like, at that time, that was in, right? How all the tight stuff is today. And yeah. Although I didn't dress like that, I knew it was a East Coast, I don't know what, rapper style. And yeah. But you know what? By that time, I already learned, like, I'm not judging any book by its cover. So
That's right.
We all dressed that era. When we had him on, we talked about how it was like the Eminem influence on all the white people. And then... that was for me anyways what got me in.
And how it was all like baggy stuff back then, and now it's like people are trying to go as skinny jeans and as tight as possible. Not me, because I'm a big guy, so that never works. But
hey, how's that work, eh? When I'm jacked and in shape, everything's baggy, and I'm fucking a little overweight and husky, and it's tight. Like, I'm like, come on.
It's going back.
We missed that step. Yeah, exactly.
Hey, question for you there, Brad. Is that Gretzky poster behind you? It's like about a half inch thick wood one, right?
Yeah.
Oh, I had the exact same one as a kid.
Yeah, and actually on my other wall here, I got, I'll flip you guys around. I actually, when I broke my leg, Brent Gretzky got me the signed one from Wayne in the hospital, and then I'll show you my other. So that's signed by Wayne when I was in the hospital. Where are we?
Wow, that's sweet.
I got one of my other favorite ones right here. If you guys can see this, it's a little Ryan Hollweg there.
Yeah, a little Ryan. I know. It's funny. You see all the autographs on my wall. I got no Hollweg or no Wingfield up here. So we got to make that happen.
We'll have to fix that up for you. No problem.
Yeah.
I need a Danbury one up here. Ryan, I remember watching you on that line with Oren Betts when you first kind of got your feet wet in NHL. That line was fucking dominant. You were another guy that was never scared to drop the mitts. Who would you say was one of the toughest guys you ever fought?
Oh, man. I don't know.
And I had to use that picture today. I had to use that picture today of you beating up Mike Ricci because, man, that guy was ugly.
Yeah, but he's in Europe, he's like a sex symbol. It's hilarious. They got a different taste over there.
he was voted one of the sexiest men or something alive.
Yeah, he was.
Or some shit.
What?
Like that.
Yeah,
what?
He was. On that, you know, Ryan Kessler's at that episode where he's like, or that magazine, it was like the one like a couple years or probably like 10 years earlier. Like, it had.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, I guess getting back to your question there, just, I feel like every guy I had to fight in the NHL was pretty tough. I was never as tall as a lot of the guys, so I was always the underdog in most of the situations. And tell you the truth, I don't even know if I remember half of them, just getting hit in the head so many times. But, yeah. I mean, Cam Jansen was a huge, because they're playing with the Devils. Those were always good tilts. A lot of respect for Cam. I mean, we had some good fights, and just with the rivalry being what it is with the Rangers and the Devils being that close across the river there, it always made those fights a little extra special and a little more wild, and bring that try to get the momentum for our team. And it was always cool playing in their building because we'd have probably more fans than they had and we're on the road. So yeah. Cam was a tough guy, probably the same size as me, but we had some good tilts for sure.
So was there one fight that you wish would have happened?
That I wish would have happened. I don't know. I mean, I'll tell you one good story. I mean, I remember playing in Vancouver, and it was kind of always my goal to wish to fight Todd Bertuzzi too. So I remember we were playing against the Canucks, and the first time my buddies back home in Vancouver would have actually seen me play on TV. And that's when Nazan was still there. It was Morrison, the West Coast Express line, right? And, Bert, I had a lot of respect for Bertuzzi, big, tough guy, like the combination with skill, just with, like a great power forward. And even part of the reason I wore 44 as well. So just a lot of respect for him. But I remember talking to some of my buddies back home the day of the game. And I'm just like, hey, guys, make sure you watch this, throw this game on today, because – I'm probably going to do something stupid. the opportunity I had to, caught Nazo with his head down, head up his ass in the neutral zone, and I crushed him. And, sure enough, he was coming right there to answer the bell, big Bert there. And, I got to live that fight out, but I was kind of always a guy I wanted to fight anyway. So I thought I took a lot of pride in that. It wasn't much of a fight. He's a big dude. He kind of manhandled me, but I kind of killed two birds with one stone there. I got to hammer Naslin and fight Big Bert there. So that was pretty cool.
The last guy that hammered Naslin never played another shift.
That's right.
Yeah.
You know, true story.
We know who we mean. As a Canuck fan, we know.
I played with Steve Moore too.
Oh, you did?
Oh, yeah. Did you really?
Yeah.
Oh, really?
In Hershey.
Oh,
yeah.
Shit.
Like before the incident, obviously, because he never played hockey again. Yeah,
that's right.
Okay. Yeah. And
I was gonna shoot. If there was, you guys were out partying. You guys were out partying, drinking, having fun with your boys or the wives, and $1,000 prize is on the line. You had to sing one karaoke song. What song would you sing?
Sweet Caroline.
Okay.
I'd have to get Holly to sing it for me. This guy, you guys should see this guy play the guitar. I don't know if you guys YouTubed him in the Czech Elite League. Was it Pilsen? Am I saying it right, Holly?
Pilsen, yeah.
Pilsen, yeah. And this guy, after the games, he would strap on the guitar in front of the crowd. And like, so if you're talking karaoke, I don't do karaoke when Holly's around, man. You make me look really, really bad.
Hey, Ryan, didn't you do Free Fallin' after Petty passed away?
Yeah, that was actually like one of the songs, in like this time when I was playing in Europe. That's what Brad was talking about. Like, it was one of the seasons I was suspended to start the season. So yeah, go figure. I got suspended. Yeah. But but I was a pretty big draw. Like, the fans really, you know, liked my style because I was really a different type of player in Europe. You know, you can imagine. But I found my little niche over there. But I remember starting the season and I was suspended, and they wanted to get me involved with, like, because I was always interacting with the fans. I mean, throughout my career, I always really appreciated the fans, and I always took time to sign autographs and give back and, you know, do events and stuff like that. But I remember the, like, the team manager guy, he like, they comes up and he's like, Ryan, will you, you play guitar after a game? And I'm like, what do you mean? I'm like, okay. I'm like, okay, whatever. So, like, I go out, long story short, you know, they got this, you know, mic all set up for me, like, you know, pick up on the guitar going across the PA, and I'm just out there in, like, my clothes, my shoes on, you know, playing in front of, like, you know, probably 6,000 people still at the game after the game. And I thought it was kind of just going to be like a, you know, start the season off one time thing. And then, you know, obviously it caught some momentum, and me being like the fan favorite and stuff, you know, they're like expecting it every game now. So I'm like, and then, you know, now you fast.
I was going to say it became the Hollweg idol.
Yeah. Right. Exactly. And then, like, fast forward, like, a couple, you know, probably about couple months in the season, it's like I'm still doing this, like, after every game we win at home. And I'm just like, it got to the point where, you know, I only have so much in my bag of songs, man. I'm like, I'm not a musician by any means, but I mean, I try to, you know, play and read some chords and stuff like that. But it got to the point, I'm like, I'm not even taking pregame naps anymore. I'm like, holy, like, what the hell? I've got to learn a new song, or I gotta, you know. So I'm like literally practicing songs before I play, because I'm like, if I get the nod to go out, I'm like, oh, I got to play something. I can't keep repeating stuff. And I remember a guy went to 1.2, and we're losing a game by, like, or we're winning a game by, like, one goal. Like, you know, it's hockey, right? Like, it's still, like, the, you know, early in the third period. And I get the athletic trainer behind me knocking on my shoulders, like, Ryan, they want to know, will you play tonight? And I'm like, what the fuck are you talking about? We got like 18 minutes to play here in the third. We're only up a goal. I'm like, get the fuck away from me. I'm worried about playing hockey here and not worried about what kind of song I'm going to play. Like, are you nuts? So I don't know. That was kind of the end of it for the year. I kind of kiboshed it, but it was fun while it lasted, for sure.
That was like the original storm surge.
Yeah, exactly.
And Brad, same question for you. You dropped your mitts too many times to count. How many fights do you actually think you got into? And who'd you say the toughest opponent you had?
Oh, I have no idea how many fights I've been in. All I know is it's more – I forgot about more fights than most people have been in. So
Okay. Fair enough.
And some of the toughest guys, like probably Pat Cote is one guy that I really wanted to fight. I fought Pierre Letourneau Lebon. He was pretty tough, yep. Young guy coming up at the time. I'm probably missing some guys here. Probably Cote was the guy that I,
okay.
Steve Bosse went on to win UFC Fight of the Year with Sean O'Donnell in 2015. He's a pretty tough guy. Obviously not much of a hockey player, but he can skate well enough. I'll tell you that.
There you go.
Yeah. So he pretty much covers it all there, Steve Bosse.
We heard some good stories about you were talking about T-Bone earlier, about the alleged Visine in the water bottles and the soaking of the jerseys and the Skittles on the bench, that kind of stuff.
I told them they need to sprinkle, as you're walking through the opposing team's bench, you just sprinkle sand a little bit onto the bench.
Were you guys actually, like, aware of him doing this? Like, did you guys know? Or
no, I had no idea. I assumed that, like, I could hear – I hear rumblings of it, but I didn't think it was as bad as it was.
Yeah.
Like, I didn't know they were sticking fish in the heat duct.
Oh, yeah, I heard about that one, too. Yeah,
I didn't know they were stealing the goalies' pads or putting Visine in their bottles. I knew they were, I saw them welding doors shut and shortening benches. Obviously, we'd check it out at pregame, laughing. But, you know, I never actually knew the extent of it. I knew they were fucking with him a little bit. But, wow, that's pretty awesome.
That is awesome. And you got to play with Gretzky. Obviously not the great one, but still, it's still a Gretzky. What was it like playing with him?
Yeah, you know what? He was he's obviously the equivalent to his brother, just at a minor league level. Like, I got to play on a line with this guy, and I can
remember. They call him the next best one.
Yeah, the next best one. Yeah, for sure. And so I was actually, and Keith Gretzky was my coach in Bakersfield, and yeah, he was more focused on gambling and drinking O'Doul's. And then one of the coolest things was, though, having Walter Gretzky around the team. And, man, I just remember seeing him in the stands, and he had such a big following. You could, whenever he'd walk somewhere, it looked like the wave, or you'd be looking. I'd be in the penalty box a lot, so I'd be looking across, and I'd be like, what is all these people doing? And then I'm like, you could see they're just following Walter Gretzky. And it was pretty wild. I remember I got into one pretty good scrap. I can't remember. I can't remember his name. But there was a lot of bloodshed. There was a big lot of blood on the ice. There was a pause to scrape it up, and I could see the crowd move, and it was Walter. And I didn't know it at the time, but he was coming down just to bang on the penalty box glass and give me a thumbs up. So I was like, wow, that's Walter Gretzky. Like that.
That's awesome.
So pretty cool stuff, yeah.
Absolutely. And Ryan, take back to your first NHL goal, and you still got the puck.
Yeah, I still got it. Yeah, the Rangers actually, for all the back then, I'm assuming they still do it, but they would take the puck and frame it for you with the score sheets and photo and stuff. So it's actually really cool. I got it. It's hanging at my parents' house. But some of the names on that score sheet were awesome. It was who were the minuses. There was Mario Lemieux was on there as a dash one. Sidney Crosby was a dash one. Sergei Gonchar. So yeah, wow. It's pretty cool. It was pretty cool to have that score sheet, and I look back at some of the names now on there, and it wasn't a pretty goal. I think I just threw it on net from like the half wall, and I think it just squeaked in, you know, on the short side, but pretty greasy goal. But
goal's a goal.
Yeah, they don't ask how, just how many, but there weren't many in pro for me.
Hey Brad, how many goals did you score with Danbury?
You know what? The first year I was off pretty good. I was on a 30 goal pace and something like an 800 minute penalty minutes. If you do it, 80 game season and 20 games, I had 7 goals, 4 assists and 178 minutes. So I would have well been on my way to a pretty good, decent year that year.
Yeah. Shit.
So, but in total in 56 games, I think I ended up with 10 goals and I don't know, over 600 minutes, I think.
Do you have Do you both have a favorite sports movie or documentary? I mean, of course, now we got the new one. Yeah, I know. I that's why the original question is sports movie, but I just threw in the documentary for shits and giggles. But
I was pretty big on Slapshot and Youngblood, let me tell you.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, I would say, you know, for me, I think Youngblood's probably one of my favorite hockey movies. I think I watched that The Last Dance with the Chicago Bulls there on Netflix, and that was an awesome documentary. I'm not a huge basketball guy, but after watching that and, you know, just getting their perception on things and things that were going on, it was pretty cool just to see that dynasty of teams and how good they really were. So, yeah, and then even watching the rest of Brad's series, they're untold. I mean, I know there was crime and penalties, but there's also four other good stories. Yeah. So, I mean, it was, I thought it was altogether like the untold series in a whole was awesome. And I have a couple more of them to watch, but I was like, there was stories I didn't even have any clue about, like the boxer and, you know, what she went through. And it was cool. I was well done. I really enjoyed watching them.
Yeah, that Malice at the Palace one was good too. Yeah. And of course we all remember that night was crazy. So I got to watching it the other night too after I finished your guys' show. Mike?
Hey Brad, what'd you think of your time over in Europe? Like, was it way different than playing here when you were playing in England?
No, not really, not in the UK. And it's the British Ice Hockey Super League at the time. It's probably the only league at that time in Europe that was playing North American style. It was actually loaded with a lot of ex-NHL heavyweight tough guys. And just what you're fighting maybe once every 5 games, once every 6 games, wasn't like at the pace in North American minors. But really good league. I had a great time there. Played for an awesome guy, and Enyo Sacilotto, one of my favorite coaches. I ever got a chance to play for. I wish I stayed longer, but that's just not how things were working out at the time.
Okay.
And with Danbury, how many times were you sent out? How many times did you get the look? Time for you to go, or the tap on the cell shoulder?
Phone. No, wow. The phone call.
Oh, yeah, we heard about the cell phone. We heard about the cell phone.
People think it was just a one-time thing, like the first game, and trust me, it was not a one-time thing. The old Motorola flip phone was coming out until Richard Brosell caught wind of it, and then we had to put her away, but that thing had to come out at least 10 times in the first five games.
That's awesome.
Could have set the tone early, huh?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, they're all about that. Good day. I guess they had some intuition or something, knew it was going to be a long time, but a good time.
If you could only eat pancakes or waffles, which one would you choose?
Pancakes.
Okay.
Good call.
Ryan likes them with chocolate chips.
Oh, I like them anyway, baby.
Yeah.
Flapjacks and pancakes.
There you go. No, I'm hungry.
And Ryan, tell us about your time in Toronto. What was it like playing in Canadian City?
It was different for sure. I mean, I was traded there from the Rangers. It was great. It was a great experience. I mean, I didn't play much there. I don't think Ron Wilson really didn't really like me, and just kind of didn't really get the opportunity that I was hoping for there. And then when Berkey came in, Brian Burke, because he took over as the general manager job that year for Fletcher, I kind of thought I would fit into their plans just as far as style, the way I played. I knew Berkey liked that harder style, but, it didn't work out. And obviously they had a different vision and a different direction. So it was a lot of fun, though. I mean, I didn't really I knew I wasn't playing every night, so I got to go out and party and enjoy the city a little bit more. I was getting healthy scraps every night and just getting bag skated every morning. So go out and have a few beers and just sweat it out in the morning. But it was crazy. You couldn't go anywhere. It was like eyeballs always on you. But it was definitely different from being in New York, because in New York they have that. You could be a big deal in New York if you're there, but you can also get lost in that city pretty easy. So it was a lot of fun, really different, but again, a great opportunity to play for a club with a lot of history, and Toronto was it was a good experience, fun experience for me.
So if you could pick up and go anywhere right now, where would we go?
NYC.
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 Honestly, yeah. I've been wanting to go out on like a tropical vacation.
Dude.
Yeah, so I need a beach or something, maybe the Maldives or whatever they call it. But I've never been there, and I'm just, my brother gets to always do cool stuff like that. So I want to be able to, like, you know, have my pictures too being in the Maldives.
Yeah, right.
Yeah, exactly. What teams he's connected with a team too, right? Is it Florida or is it Tampa or?
Yeah, he's with the Florida Panthers. So he was actually working for the Vancouver Canucks when he was still here. He was on their arena ops side and, working for the Aquilinis. And the Florida Panthers actually were headhunted him. The owner of the Florida Panthers is a West Point military alum. And my brother went to the West Point Military Academy as well. So I think that connection, cool. is what spiked their interest about him, and he had the opportunity to go there and live out his dream, being on the executive side of an NHL team. So he's I'm super proud of him, and I know he's enjoying his opportunity there, and I'm really proud of him as well.
Absolutely. And Brad, I got to hear the story about the team that sent out a guy that sucker punched you.
Oh, yeah. He's actually a local guy from Langley, and he's been running his mouth. I've read a few interviews saying he challenged me to a fight. That's why I slashed more of the head. The guy never said a word to me. So I don't even want to say his name because he's
saying. No, you don't need him.
No, but anyways, well, that's my first game in the Quebec League. And right off the hop, there was huge talk about Steve Bossé. So first shift, Steve Bossé's out there. You gotta get in there. Jump in, right? Both feet. So I fought Bossé right off the hop. It was an all right fight. He actually lost his footing and went down. He apologized. I was like, oh, don't worry about it. I'm sure we'll have lots of other opportunities. And he had very broken English at the time, but I got the gist of it. And after that, we ended up in bench clearing brawl. That was my first bench clear I've been in. So pretty wild. And by the end of the game, I was still in the game. I never got thrown out in the bench clear. And even on the power play, and I was a stretch guy on the blue line, and I remember having I had some words with their coach, right? And I was just, you know, I'm not going to say what I said to him, but I'm sure you guys can use your imagination being out in Quebec. And just my first time being out there. And I guess he didn't like what I had to say, and I didn't really like being chirped by a balding, gray-haired guy. So I was coming across on the stretch blue line looking at their bench, but I was looking back into my end, so I'm facing their bench, and no substitution or anything. This kid just jumped on the ice and came. I didn't even see him coming. Like, you know, I'm assuming he came off the bench and just suckered me. I remember I got up onto one knee and I was kind of dizzy. I stood up. He had fallen down. He threw off all his gloves and came skating at me like we're going to have a fair fight after he sucker punched me. And, you know, I think he had a good seizure. It looked like it was a good little shake on the ground, on the ice there.
That's awesome.
Who's your favorite actor or actress?
Holly. Get after it, Holly.
My favorite actor? Kevin Costner.
Okay. Yeah, he's good. Tom Cruise, I like him. Okay. Keanu, he's pretty good. He's pretty good in John Wick, man.
Yeah, he is.
Yeah, I like Keanu. Yeah, he was the goalie in Youngblood.
Oh, yeah, that's right. Yeah, because I already forgot about that. But, oh, you get into actresses, and geez, I don't know, Scarlett Johansson's, you know, you got to like her.
100%.
Right?
Blake Lively.
Blake Lively. Who's the Canadian that was, she was in...
Pamela Anderson.
Oh, yeah, well, everyone loves old Pamela Anderson, little Baywatch. No, but she was...
Probably lives right by you.
Yeah. Anyways, I'm losing my train of thought here. Now.
Pam does that to me all the time.
Hey, Pam. Comox.
Yeah. So, if you guys could play any other sport professionally, what would it have been?
Ooh.
UFC.
Probably like baseball for me.
Okay.
You guys got it pretty chill, man. They just go on the road and
make money.
Have a series of games. Yeah. They get paid. You know, not, you know, especially like maybe like a bullpen catcher would be really good, you know.
That's right.
You know, get paid like $1 million a year just to be, you know, catching balls and, you know, no pressure, go on the road.
Yeah.
That's right. That's right.
I think Holly's on to something there. I was going to say something like Australian rules football, but. Yeah, thinking baseball and knowing my buddy Ryan Dempster there, I think that's the way to go.
Absolutely. Yeah,
well, we've been trying to holler at Dempster too for a while, trying to get him on the show.
Oh, maybe I'll
Winger's your guy. Winger's your guy.
Yeah, I mean, he's got about 30 relatives here on the coast. I could kidnap one of them. And, you
know. Yeah, we'll tell him.
I'll send Ryan a message for you guys.
Perfect.
Awesome. That would be sweet. Did either of you guys have any weird pregame rituals or routines?
Yeah, you haven't seen my dance that I used to have to do in New York?
Oh, man. No. You guys got to watch that on YouTube.
Oh, man.
You got all the names, Shanahan, who all, everyone, Jaeger standing around watching this guy doing hat flips. And oh, my God, you guys got to watch all.
Okay.
Okay. Mike, you're on the finding highlights. So
yeah, absolutely.
Easy to find. I think it's like the first thing that pops up if you put my name in YouTube.
Hey, now we'll be number two.
Yeah, I know. We were kind of going through a stretch of, losing, kind of in a drought. And I just, you know, I was like, you know, the glue guy on the team, you know, tried to keep the boys loose and having fun. And I don't know, we had a large number of European guys on the team that year as well. So at that time, it was like so much techno music in the room. It was like, oh my God, like, can we just play a mix at least of some other stuff too? And I remember just like this one song used to come on all the time, and I'm sitting next to like Yogs in the dressing room, and Strack is on my left, Jagger's on my right, and then this song, like techno song, comes on. I just started like air banding kind of like a drum, and it just like evolved into like back, like cartwheels and just, you know, sprinklers and lawnmower moves for dancing. And it's pretty, and you know, we ended up winning the next game, and that became another thing that I had to do before every game for the rest of the season. It was tiring. Like, I was sweating by the end of it. I didn't even need a warm up after that. You know, I was like, I'm good to go. So
you probably got cold sitting on the bench after that.
I only play 5 minutes a night. Wasn't too bad. I get most of my minutes in the first period, so I was all right.
Yeah. Set the tone.
That's awesome. Hey, both you guys, I want to thank you guys very much for taking the time for us today and coming on and chat with us. Honestly, you guys had some great stories. We love that shit, so we appreciate it.
Hey guys, can I just thanks very much for having us. So Ryan's got our hat on there. We got New Angle Hockey Development. You guys can search us up on Facebook, search us up on Instagram. It's Ryan, myself, and our good friend Chris Shaw, who's the boss of that program. Great coach and GM of the Northwest Hawks. So if you guys want to check that out, it'd be awesome. We're specialized in all ages development, all skill levels.
Mike's been talking to you, maybe just send him over the info and we'll plug that in.
Yeah, we'll plug it into the interview. Just send me your guys' Ryan, if you want to just send me the website or whatever. And I have the Instagram account. I already tagged it in this one. So I'll tag you guys again in the video as well.
Sounds good. Yeah, and for me too, we didn't really get into it, but I'm starting my own food truck too. So we'll be in the lower mainland here, and it's called South Jersey Pies. It's there's a whole story behind that, but okay, I won't get into it now. But yeah, it'll be cool. So if you guys are around too, or you ever need to do any events or anything like that, you know, we can keep in touch. And
sounds like a good sponsor, you know.
Yeah. Absolutely. Hey, absolutely.
If you're ever in Coquitlam at the John B, that's my sponsor. So if you want to come have some beers at the John B,
I know the John B very well.
Perfect. So that's our sponsor. Spot,
so
hey, right, funny you guys say that. Good friends of mine own the John B.
Right on.
The Lipinski family and my good friend Kevin Amoka. I played junior hockey with, married to Tara Lipinski, and that's their bar. So we should definitely meet at the John B. Thank you guys 100%. Thanks very much for having me on. You guys, I really appreciate it.
Another thing, Ryan, talk to the breweries down in Port Moody. I got a little bit pulled down there, but not a lot. But yeah, talk to them down there, and they have food trucks every Friday, Saturday night. So I'd be sick if you set up down there.
Yeah, my buddy lives down there, so that's definitely something we've been talking about. And that's kind of like we're just looking to get into a brewery once or twice a week for right now, just to get things going. We're still finishing it up. It's not complete. The build on it's not. We're probably about a month and a half out from the being done, but we got the recipe down and what we're going to be cooking. So that's the main part.
Hey, guys, I'm just going to tell you, I've had these guys of Sheena and Ryan have cooked for us with the South Jersey Pies. Man, it's unbelievable. You guys got to try these things.
We'll keep all those plugs and stuff. We'll keep that part in there.
100%.
Perfect.
And we'll talk Ryan, soon. The other one, one sec. Let them do their drop. But Ryan, one other one you should check out is it's Daggerad. It's in Burnaby.
Okay.
Daggerad.
Yeah.
And they have a food truck, I think, even more than that. I think it's like Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday, something like that. And they're always looking for – I see them asking for food trucks. So
okay, cool.
Check it out.
Awesome. Thanks for letting me know that.
Boom. Perfect.
Let's hit the John B.
Woo! Yeah, absolutely.
Okay. Let us know, boys. Let us know.
Yeah, for sure. Absolutely. Honestly, I'm in there every Monday night for football. But if you want to go have some drinks on the company card too, we can always go down there on a Saturday.
Yeah. Yeah, let us know, guys.
Looking for the most beers on tap? Great steaks, great staff? Head over to the John B. Pub.
We got the best beers, steaks, chicken wings, nachos in town. Come see us at the John B. Pub.
The John B. Pub, the best bar in town. Come sign up for our football pool. Say hey, St. You.